of Ruth, or Buckaroo, whatever you. Last week we ended up with verse 18 of chapter 1, where Naomi, the mother-in-law of Ruth, realizes that Ruth is in fact determined about going back from Moab. Ruth isn't going back. It's not like a return to Bethlehem for her, because she has not been there. She was a Moabitess woman, and Moabite was her home country, if you please, or Moab. And but Naomi is going back. And so Ruth, it says, verse 16 of chapter 1. Let's pray before we enter into this morning. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for this beautiful story of Ruth and the way you are able to. I thank you for the way you involve yourself with restoration and redemption. And so, Lord, help us to learn more about that aspect of the lives of the people here in the book of Ruth. In Jesus' name, amen. In verse 16, let's go back there, verse 16 of chapter 1, where Naomi has said, just in the previous verse, stay in Moab with your sister-in-law. And Ruth says, but entreat me not to leave you or to turn back from following after you. Wherever you go, I will go. And wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me and more also, if anything but death parts you and me. So she, Ruth, is determined in her heart that she wants to go with her mother-in-law. And so when Naomi saw that she was determined to go with her, she stopped speaking to her. In other words, she stopped talking to her about that particular area. So when she saw that she was determined to go with her, she stopped speaking to her. Now, look at the first part of verse 19. Now, the two of them went away until they came to Bethlehem. Now, the two widow ladies here, Naomi and Ruth, probably visited the three graves of their loved ones for the last time before they left Moab. And I'm just speculating about this stuff here. And so then they committed themselves to what lay ahead in Bethlehem, and then they set out for Bethlehem to begin a new life. And to me, it would be interesting to know what Naomi and Ruth talked about as they journeyed from Moab to Bethlehem. And, you know, wouldn't you like to be, you know, something hovering around there to listen to these two ladies as they headed back to Bethlehem? it was evident that Ruth was committed to Ruth and to go living in Bethlehem and committed to the God of the Israelites. And so she probably had a lot of questions. And so, did Naomi, I asked, give her daughter-in-law some basic instruction in the law of Moses, because she knew it pretty good? Did Ruth ask questions about the Jewish faith, about the Jewish people, and what was going to be her new home in Bethlehem? And then, if she does that, I wonder what kind of answers Naomi would have given Ruth. Because, you see, Naomi was going back a bitter woman. And at this point, her faith in God was kind of faltering. And I think it was a great encouragement to Ruth. Ruth saw something in Naomi that attracted her, not only to Naomi, but to Naomi's people and to Naomi's God. So there was still something there. And now notice the second part of this verse. And it happened when they had come to Bethlehem that all the city was excited because of them, and the women said, "Is this Naomi?" Now, the people of Bethlehem were glad to see Naomi upon her return from Moab. And then, as we have previously mentioned, Moab was just a short distance, probably around 55 miles, give or take, away from Bethlehem. And the folks in Bethlehem may have been well aware of the personal tragedy that Naomi had experienced in Moab. The deaths of her husband, Elimelech, and the death of her two sons, Mahlon and Chilion. So they said, "Is this Naomi?" Now, Naomi, by translation, means pleasant. Means pleasant. And so Naomi says to them, "Do not call me Naomi. Call me Mara," which means bitter. "For the Almighty has dwelt very bitterly with me. I went out full, and the Lord has brought me home again empty. Why do you call me Naomi, since the Lord has testified against me and the Almighty has afflicted me?" Based upon what Naomi went through, with the loss of her husband, the loss of her two sons-in-law, two sons. Loss of her husband, loss of her two sons. This was somewhat of a natural reaction. See? Where we say, if we have any thought that God might be involved in the affairs of this world, we have a tendency to blame God when we face adversity. But here's where the rub comes in. But we are not too eager to praise God when things are going great. See? And so Naomi, well, let me give you a quick illustration. My stepdad and our family, years ago, in 1974, had quite a tragedy where my 12-year-old sister, my 14-year-old brother, were tragically killed in a big log/water slide that came down this, what before was just a little creek, until the rains came down and stuff like that. And they were killed. And so my stepdad, who wasn't a believer at that point, and he really did not have hardly any respect for Christian people. His dad, whose name was Moses, took that name to the extreme, where he was going to be the ruler and everything like that, and would lock my father, my stepfather, and his two sisters up in chicken coops in Oklahoma for hours at a time if they did something wrong. So as a result, my stepdad had a lot of anger built up against God and against people who had a belief or an allegiance to God. And if some of the people were here this morning that knew him, and especially the people of the Wyatt Christian Church, they could tell you, yeah, the verbal abuse that was heaped upon them by my stepdad. And when those kids died, oh man, he, one blame after another, he just could not rest, could not rest. And it was a little while before, when we were sitting in a room together in a borrowed home, because our home had been destroyed, he says, I wish I knew why this happened. And at the risk of him lashing out at me, I said, you know what, Emery? God knows. And that's all I have to offer. He says, I don't know. I don't know. And then it shifted. He said, I just wish I could do something for those kids. And I said, well, you can establish something in their honor. But I says, I do know one thing. I said, sometime back, when one of my brothers had been injured and was in the hospital in San Francisco, I was driving with my sister. I'd come up and we'd gone down to see my brother, and I was driving down. My folks were coming down later, and as we're driving down, Kathy prays for her brother who's in the hospital. And as kind of a P.S. to God in her prayer, she says, in God, I pray that my daddy would come to know Jesus. Because Kathy had been led to the Lord in Sunday school just a short time earlier. And so I shared that with my stepdad. I said, you know, Kathy's desire was that her daddy would come to know Jesus. He looked at me, big old tears in his eyes, says, I'm going to do something about that. A month later, he gave his heart to the Lord. See? And changed man. But until we really understand God's involvement, for good or adversely in our lives, we don't have a good concept of God. And I think Pop, he would say many, he would say several years later, I remember him in a breakfast at the, a men's breakfast at the elementary school there in Miranda, the Men of the We Ought Church, and he was sharing. Different ones were sharing, and Pop said, you know what? If those kids, he said, if Kathy and Jimmy would not have perished, I may not have never come to know God. So then he understood. Kind of like what you shared yesterday, and then you shared with the folks how some of the guys at the prison said, you know, I'm thankful that I'm in prison, because if I hadn't come up here, I wouldn't have known the Lord. So when we have that concept, so Naomi, very bitter. But we're going to see, as we go through here, we're going to see how God takes her bitterness, you know, and brings her back to the real Naomi, pleasant. It's amazing. And she'd been away, for 10 years. And the women of the town were probably shocked when they saw her. And their question is, this Naomi suggests both, probably, I think, surprise and bewilderment. She was not the Naomi in the countenance that she wore at that particular time. She was not the Naomi whom they had known 10 years before. Her 10 difficult years in Moab with the deaths of her husband and sons, and the sorrows they had brought, things like that take the toll on us. Physically, mentally, the whole works. So instead of making her better, in her mind, the trials of life had made her bitter, which is the meaning of the word, like I mentioned a moment ago, Mara, bitterness. And then verse 22 here, down at the, says, so Naomi returned, and Ruth the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law with her, who returned from the country of Moab. Now they came to Bethlehem at the beginning of barley harvest. So this I think is put in here to give us an idea of what the time was. Barley harvest, barley was harvested in late April through early May, and then the wheat harvest, which are mentioned later on in this chapter, followed in May and then early June. So, chapter 2, Boaz comes upon the scene. What do we know about Boaz? Who was Boaz's mama? Rahab. What was Rahab? She was a prostitute. She was a harlot. So, I came across this, and I just thought, well, I'd give this to you for your information. When you read the genealogy of Jesus Christ in Matthew chapter 1, you find the names of five women, four of whom have very questionable credentials. Right? We've talked about this before. Listen to this. Tamar committed incest with her father-in-law. Genesis chapter 38. Rahab was a prostitute, a Gentile harlot. Joshua chapter 2, verse 1. Ruth was an outcast Gentile Moabitess and the wife of Uriah. Remember her? Uriah the Hittite? She was involved in an adulterous relationship with King David. See? And all of those folks, not only David, but all of those women, with very questionable credentials, become a part of the family of the Messiah. Pardon? Yeah. Well, Mary's mentioned here. Yeah. And yeah. But isn't it amazing that the names in Scripture, like Ruthie has just mentioned there in Genesis, the names that are used, of the women that are used, are all, like we say here, have very questionable credentials. That speaks to us. That speaks to us. It spoke to me this morning when I was going over this. It spoke to me this morning. When what? Yeah. We all have questionable credentials. Okay? All right?
I just want to mention, I did a Bible study on this one.
Speak up, babe.
Oh. It's on. Can you hear me? Okay. Out at Shelter Cove, I was asked to just teach a Bible study at the other church one time, and I did it on the genealogy and highlighted each one of those women, and I had somebody come up to me afterwards and say, what did that have to do with anything? Oh. Couldn't believe it.
It speaks to us, each one of us, you know. And breaking out every window in an elementary school building in Myers Flat hardly classifies as an awesome credential for someone to teach a Sunday morning Bible class. But praise the Lord.
Maybe that's part of the early hints, if you will, that actually salvation was going to be available across the board.
And across the board. You bet. You bet. Whosoever will. Whosoever will. And I heard a preacher, I think he's an evangelist, years ago, say, you know, if the wealthiest man in town with the best credentials comes, stands at the front of the church, and the person who's the worst guy with the worst reputation in town comes and stands before, and the pastor says, what are you here for? And both of them say, I'd like to pray to receive Christ. When the guy, rich guy with all of the stuff, good stuff behind him, when he prays, and when the goofball crook or whatever, when he prays, God is obligated by his word and what he did on the cross to save him. He's obligated himself, God has, to whoever comes to save them. I like that. I like that. And I see it time and time again at the mission. these guys who are absolutely, in their mind, outcasts, worthless, drug addicts, someone like a Ray Vogel who came here. Did Ray come here with blonde with the long hair and share 30-year meth addict? See? And when he comes and it's been neat when he told me, no, in certain terms, that it'd be a cold day, and you know what, before he came into the mission. And then he went through some physical stuff that he realized there wasn't any hope physically. And then he thought, well, I'll come to the mission. And he came, and shortly after he came in, he gave his heart to the Lord. And, you know, like he told me Friday, he says, Tommy, I'm graduating here in just a few months. And he says, I still got a lot of rough edges. I says, I've been around this stuff over 50 years, and I still got a lot of rough edges. You don't believe me? Just ask my wife. He says, I've talked to your wife, and I would agree with that. But you see, as we're going to see here in the book of Ruth, God brings together an outcast Gentile Moabitess woman and the son of a Gentile harlot, and weaves together an awesome and beautiful true life illustration of restoration and redemption. So don't miss it. Don't miss it here. Nancy.
I was just thinking, Boaz, was he just half Jewish or only one quarter? Or... because
Rahab was not an Israelite.
Okay, so
she was a Gentile harlot.
And her husband was who? Solomon.
Solomon.
So he was a Jew.
Yeah.
So Boaz is half Jew. Yeah. Naomi is no Jew.
Yeah.
So that means their offspring is only one quarter.
Yeah.
To start with.
If you look
okay.
at it that way, yeah.
Okay. Just
okay.
Doing some calculations.
But Boaz, it seems evident, had this allegiance to the God of Israel for a lot of years, okay, and knew this stuff quite well. Now, verse 2. So, did you have a comment, Pastor? We pastors can have a rough time with sometimes. Oh, amen. Verse 2, so Ruth the Moabitess said to Naomi, please let me go to the field and glean heads of grain after him, in whose sight I may find favor. Now, the law required landowners to leave the grain at the edges of the fields and any husk or ears or anything like that that the harvesters drop. Write this down, Deuteronomy. Well, I'm going to take time to read it. So you have it. Deuteronomy chapter 24. Beginning at verse 19, three verses here. When you reap your harvest in your field and forget a sheaf in the field, S-H-E-A-F, you shall not go back to get it. It shall be for the stranger, the fatherless, and the widow, that the Lord your God may bless you in all the work of your hands. When you beat your olive trees, you shall not go over the boughs again. It shall be for the stranger, the fatherless, and the widow. When you gather the grapes of your vineyard, you shall not glean it afterward. It shall be for the stranger, the fatherless, and the widow. Gleaning. Gleaning has been done for eons. Eons. I met a fellow. I'd done a memorial service for this fellow out in Shelter Cove, and one of his relatives came and was sharing with me. He was retired, but his job was supervisor for the gleaners down in the valley, here in California, down in the Central Valley. And after they had harvested the crops, then they hired him. He came on duty year after year after year, and he would go through and all the gleaners would come in, and he would be in charge of showing them where they could glean and where they couldn't glean. So it's still done in this day and age. It's done right here in Southern Humboldt. you know, at different places. Matol, some of you know Matol. He and his family had a blueberry. They have a blueberry farm, and at the end of every season, when they've sold off all the blueberries, they're going to do and I don't know whether he still does it, but he'd say, "Okay, we invite you out. You're at your own risk. If you fall and break a leg, you take care of it. I'm not responsible." But he says, "Go through and you can pick all the blueberries that you want." See, and Matol called it what? Gleaning. So the poor, the aliens, the widows, the fatherless were supposed to be allowed to glean. And Ruth's plan was to glean behind anyone in whose sight she might find favor. And as a Moabitess widow, an alien, she may not have known that. She may not have known that in Israel, gleaning was a right, not necessarily a special privilege. It was a right. Or she may have known not all landowners respected God's law in that regard. So Naomi tells her to go glean. So Ruth heads out to the barley field. And so Ruth says, "Please let me go to the field and glean heads of grain after him on whose side am I find favor." And she said to her, Naomi says, "Go." So she heads out. Now, notice the second part of verse 3. "And she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the family of Elimelech." Now let me make a statement here. The whole story of the book of Ruth doesn't make much sense without the understanding that on the day that Ruth happened on to Boaz and happened onto his field, God was directing her to the right place at the right time with the right person to help meet her needs. God does that with a lot of us. God does that to a lot of us. And so this word "happened" is a neat word. It's used many times in Scripture. The Apostle Paul said to the Philippians, when he wrote to them, he lists a bunch of stuff that had taken place in his life. And as we've gone and continue to go through the book of Acts, we discover certain things where Paul was threatening this. And Paul said to the Philippian people, "I want to let you know that the things that happened to me only helped get out the gospel." Get out the gospel. And then we need to take it that way. What can we do? How can we use this circumstance to share the gospel? Either now or in the very near future. So the right person comes to the field and he greets the reaper. So he comes and he says, "Behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem, said to the reapers, 'The Lord be with you.' And they answered him, 'The Lord bless you.' Then Boaz said to his servant who was in charge of the reapers, 'Whose young woman is this? Whose young woman is this?'" Because you see, it was unusual for just a young, independent woman to be out there gleaning. And Boaz is using, I think, some excellent courtesy. He inquires about Ruth. He gets the answer from the servant. But I want to mention this to you for your information. I think it's good information. When Boaz spots Ruth gleaning, he does not initially address her directly, nor does he infringe on the rights of any man who may be in her life. His question to the servant, when he says, "Whose young woman is this?" he's probably seeking information about her husband, perhaps her father, perhaps her master, if she's working for somebody. And you see, a young woman, like I mentioned, would rarely glean independently. Only when he finds there is no man responsible for her, other than this woman named Naomi, whom he probably knows to be a relative, does he... It's then that he he addresses Ruth directly. And notice what he says, verse 8. Then Boaz said to Ruth, "You will listen, my daughter, will you not? Don't go to glean in another field, nor go from here, but stay close by my young women. Let your eyes be on the field which they reap, and go after them," or follow after them. "Have I not commanded the young men not to touch you? And when you are thirsty, go to the vessels and drink from what the young men have drawn." I want you to keep in mind now, Ruth does not know the involvement that this man is going to have in her life. Neither does Boaz know the involvement that this woman is going to have in his life. But I really think it's to Boaz's credit that he reaches out to this young woman like he does. He is a good landowner, and I feel that he knows exactly what the law says when it comes to gleaning. Yes.
And, excuse me. Since she was introduced as the young woman who came back with Naomi, and he would have known the story, he did know that she was kind of at least a shirt tail relative, right?
Yeah. I think he could tell perhaps by looking at her that maybe she had a different way about her as far as maybe the color of her skin or whatever. I don't know. But the servant had already said, she's not from here. She's that Moabitess woman who came back with Naomi. See? And so he says that, he says those words, words of protection, words of concern, words of I'm going to help you. I'm going to help you. So it's to the credit of Boaz that he is not only a good landowner, but he cares for the people that are gleaning in his field. See? And somehow, some way, he notices this young woman out there on her own. Don't know all what why he noticed that, but he did. And so she fell on her face, and she bowed down to the ground and said to him, I mean, a sign of great respect, "Why have I found favor in your eyes that you should take notice of me, since I am a foreigner?" I am a foreigner. And so Boaz answered, and he said to her, "It has been fully reported to me." In other words, he was well aware, like Carol just mentioned, all that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband, and how you have left your father and your mother and the land of your birth and have come to a people whom you did not know before. So here's what I feel. Boaz, before he has this encounter out in the field with Ruth, because he is a relative or just part of the area there, he hears about, he knew about the fact that Naomi had left several years before. She had lost her husband, lost her sons, and then one of her daughters-in-law had great respect for her and was willing to come back to Bethlehem with her. And so it seems that Boaz was aware of that, and then, in having not seen the woman yet, and when he inquires, the servant says, "This is the woman that came back with Naomi." And so Boaz, okay. Then he puts it together, okay? And here's what he does. How you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband, how you have left your father and your mother and the land of your birth. We talked about this a little bit last week, how it must have been something else for her to tear herself away from her family. "And you've come to a people whom you did not know before." And then he says this, "The Lord repay your work, and a full reward be given you by the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for refuge." See, and that, what Boaz says adds punch to what Ruth said, and her commitment to Naomi when she said, your people will be my people and your God will be my God. And Boaz is giving, even though he probably doesn't realize, he's given a commentary on what Ruth said when he says, you have come to the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for refuge. Let's stop right there for today. And let me mention this. Verse 13, the next verse here, forms a bridge between what has taken place so far with Boaz and Ruth and what is about to take place. Because it says, Ruth says, let me find favor in your sight, my Lord, for you have comforted me and have spoken kindly to your maidservant, though I am not like one of your own maidservants. So tune in next week so we can see how Ruth finds favor in the sight of Boaz. In the sight of Boaz. Any questions or comments? Good book. It's a good book. Again, a book of a great true life illustration of restoration and redemption. Picture both as it applies to Jesus, and we're going to find that out. What do you have this morning, Pastor?
Ephesus, third missionary journey.
Paul's third missionary journey, that brings him to Ephesus, from which we get the word letter to the Ephesians. Awesome. As one of the guys says, the Ephesians. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for your love. Thank you for these folks. And, yep, Ruthie was right. We don't bring the greatest credentials before you. But I'm thankful that you look at us and you know that. And you save us. And then you instruct us so that we can become credentialed followers of Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.